Now that you have a basic understanding of what a limit is, we're going to put some real theory behind limits, some rules behind them, so you'll learn their properties, and then be able to develop some analytic rules to make finding limits simpler than just looking at a graph or making tables. In order to find limits analytically, we need to develop some rules, and these rules are kind of shortcuts that are going to make finding limits analytically a lot faster than finding limits graphically or numerically. In fact, you're going to learn to use graphical and numeric techniques as a last resort. We'll start with the constant rule. The limit of some constant b as x approaches c is equal to that constant b. That is a horizontal line at y equals b. So it's going to be b no matter what this value of x is. For example, the limit of 5 as x approaches 2 is just 5. Now we have something called the power rule, which we're going to apply to x to the first power. The limit of x as x approaches c is equal to c. This is a linear function. For example, the limit of x as x approaches 2 is 2. The power rule can be applied beyond x to the first power. In fact, if we take x to any power, the limit of x to a power, n, as x approaches c, is equal to c to the n power. For example, let's take the cubic function. The limit of x to the third power as x approaches 2 is equal to 2 to the third power, that's equal to 8. So this power rule gives us the ability to analyze functions where x is taken to any power, whether it's 1 or any power n. Let's look at some more complex analytic rules. Let's take a function, limit of f of x, where x approaches c, and we'll call that limit capital L. And another function, g of x, as x approaches c, and we'll call that limit k, two separate functions with separate limits. The constant multiple rule says that we can take the limit of any constant multiplied by any function, f of x, as x approaches c. The limit is the constant multiplied by the limit of the function. The sum and difference rule of two functions, the limit of any function plus or minus another function as x approaches c is equal to the limit of the first function plus or minus the limit of the second function. And the product rule says the limit of two functions f of x and g of x multiplied by each other as x approaches c is equal to the limit of the first function times the limit of the second function. So if this seems like common sense, it is. We're going to be able to use the limits of each of those functions, and if we're adding the functions or subtracting them, we're going to be able to add or subtract the limits. Same thing for multiplication. And oh, by the way, the same thing is true for division. The quotient rule says the limit of f of x divided by g of x as x approaches c is equal to the limit of the f of x function at c divided by the limit of the g of x function at c. We can expand that power rule beyond just x to a power and make it f of x to a power. The limit of f of x, such as, let's take the function x squared plus 3. The limit of x squared plus 3 raised to a power. So the limit of f of x raised to a power as x approaches c is the limit of the original function, f of x, raised to the power. There are analytic rules for trigonometric functions as well. The limit of sine of x as x approaches c is equal to the sine of c. The same is true for the cosine function. The limit of the cosine of x as x approaches c is equal to the cosine of c. So again, we're substituting that value of c in everywhere we see x. This also works for the tangent function and the cofunctions, cosecant, secant, and cotangent, as long as the function has a value at that point. Now, for example, you know that the tangent of pi over 2 is undefined. So we couldn't evaluate this limit at pi over 2. As long as the function is defined, at that point, it's going to work. Two other analytic trigonometric rules that come up fairly frequently, the limit of sine x over x as x approaches 0 is actually 1. And this is because at very small values of x, the sine of x is approximately equal to x. Also, the limit of 1 minus cosine x over x as x approaches 0 is equal to 0. So let's take all of this together and try and develop a strategy or process for finding limits analytically. First thing we're going to try to do is use that direct substitution by plugging C into the function everywhere we see the input variable, usually x. This is the easiest method, but it only works if the function is continuous at that point. If direct substitution fails, we'll try to factor it and cancel out some of the factors that are causing us trouble. And then we'll use direct substitution after that. Another technique for analytic limit finding is rationalization. If we have a radical, we need to multiply by the conjugate to eliminate the radical, and that's another method. So let's look at some examples. Let's evaluate the limit of x squared minus 4x plus 1 as x approaches negative 2. We can use direct substitution here. By everywhere we see x, we're going to put in c, which is in this case negative 2. So we're going to put in negative 2 here, here, and here. So we get negative 2 squared minus 4 times negative 2 plus 1, which is equal to 13. So the limit as of this function as x approaches negative 2 is 13. Here's a rational function. Let's look at its limit. The limit of 2x minus 6 over x minus 2 as x approaches negative 2. Using direct substitution, we put in a negative 2 here and here for x. 2 times negative 2 minus 6 over negative 2 minus 2, and we get 5 over 2, 2.5. So the limit of this function as x approaches negative 2 is equal to 5 over 2. Faster than trying to use graphical or numeric means. If direct substitution fails, we use cancellation. We try to factor and cancel out the things that are causing us trouble. For example, if we looked at this function's limit as x approaches negative 2, we're going to try direct substitution first, but we get 0 over 0, and this is called an indeterminate form. There, 0 over 0, we can't figure that out. We should try cancellation then, and that is to factor the function, cancel anything out that we can, and then see if that gets rid of the 0 in the denominator that's causing us this trouble. And indeed, if we factor out the numerator and denominator, we get this factorization, and the x plus 2's cancel out. When the x plus 2's cancel out, we'll try direct substitution of negative 2 in for x. When you do that, that gives us 1.5. So the limit of this function as x approaches negative 2 is not indeterminate. We can find it. It's 1.5, or 3 over 2. If those methods fail, we can try rationalization. And that usually involves, rationalization involves taking a function that has radicals in it and using the conjugate to get rid of those radicals. For example, if we try to evaluate this function, direct substitution, we get that indeterminate form again with 0 in the denominator. To solve this problem, we're going to use rationalization. So we're going to multiply this function by its conjugate and get rid of radicals. And you remember from algebra 2, when we multiply a radical function by its conjugate, that's going to produce something that gets rid of all the radicals. The middle terms cancel out. We get the square root of x plus 2 squared minus the square root of 2 squared all over the denominator. Now, the denominator looks more complicated now, but you're going to see what happens is this becomes x plus 2 minus 2 in the numerator, which leaves just x in the numerator, and the x in the denominator cancel each other out, giving us something that we can now evaluate using direct substitution. When we put in a 0 now for x, we're going to get 1 over the square root of 2 plus the square root of 2, which is 1 over 2 square roots of 2. So the limit of this function as x approaches 0 is 1 over 2 square roots of 2. Now, sometimes methods that we've talked about appear to not work because we wind up with something that either at positive infinity, negative infinity, or does not exist. So to determine which, we have to look at the signs of both the left and the right-hand limits. In other words, as we approach the number from the left-hand side and the right-hand side. If the signs are the same, either positive or negative, then the solution is going to be either positive infinity or negative infinity. However, if the signs don't agree, we're going to two different points, then the limit doesn't exist. That's one of the three cases where a limit does not exist. So let's look at an example of that. If we take the limit of 2x plus 5 over x minus 2 as x approaches 2, and we try to evaluate that using direct substitution, we get 9 over 0. What we're going to have to do now is consider the left and right hand limits. We're going to look at numbers as we get close to 2 from the left-hand side, say 1. Put in a 1. Well, when you do that, you're going to get a negative sign as we approach from the left. So the limit as x approaches 2, and this little minus sign means from the left-hand side, is equal to a negative number. Well, if we do the same thing and put in a number greater than 2, like say 3, we wind up with a positive number. So the limit as x approaches 2 from the positive side is positive. Therefore, the limit does not exist, DNE, because we're approaching a positive infinity from the right-hand side and negative infinity from the left-hand side. Let's look at the limit of 4 over x squared as x approaches 0. If we try to evaluate that using direct substitution, we get 4 over 0. We can't cancel or simplify it in any way, so we look at the left and right hand limits. Well, the limit of this function as x is approaching 0 from the left hand side, if we put in negative numbers for x, we're going to get a positive number. If we put in positive values of x greater than 0, approaching from the right hand side, we also get a positive number. Since those signs agree, the solution is positive infinity. So the limit of this function, 4 over x squared, as x approaches 0, is positive infinity. Let's put all of this together in a general strategy for finding limits. First of all, let's try these first two steps are analytic methods. Try that first, it's usually much faster. Use direct substitution if you can. If direct substitution fails, try to find a similar function by cancellation or rationalization. If that fails, evaluate the function numerically or graphically. And using one of these methods, you're going to be able to find the limit if it exists. So we've greatly expanded your toolbox for solving limits by giving you some analytic methods to solve them. And usually the analytic methods are much faster than numerical or graphical methods.